Welcome, everyone. My name is Lisa Christensen, the President and CEO of the Alaska World Affairs Council, and it's such a pleasure to be here with everyone today. It's so wonderful to see some familiar faces and some new faces. We are the Alaska World Affairs Council. We've been around longer than Alaska's been a state, and we are part of 90-plus councils around the United States, and we're committed to global competency and unfiltered programs like the one you're going to see today. Today's program is part of the Evangeline Atwood Distinguished Speaker Series, and it's the first one we've done in person in over a year. So we are so thrilled that this is going to be our first one in person. And if you remember before, we used to have a social media guru competition. So what that means is you don't have to put away your cell phones. Keep them on, but turn them off so they don't ring. We do like the ringtones. However, this is all being recorded for the Ambassador's Live Facebook stream, which we will get a copy of and put on our website. So if you could just put it on mute, but take pictures, tweet, set it on Instagram, Facebook. We're gonna be watching, and at the end, we are going to designate who the social media guru is, and we have great prizes for that. We are joined today by my friend and a board member of the Alaska World Affairs Council, Executive Director of World Trade Center, Mr. Greg Wolf. And this program is in partnership with the World Trade Center, the Anchorage Museum, and the Alaska Seeds of Change. And if you're not familiar with the Alaska Seeds of Change, they employ and empower local youth and promote self-reliance and the community involvement to grow and sell fresh produce. And it's a really interesting organization. I suggest that you look at their website. Also, World Trade Center has a lot of great programs, and of course, the Anchorage Museum. A special thanks to our members and our supporters and our partners who make this possible, especially the Atwood Foundation and ConocoPhillips. And if you're a student, I think I saw a couple of you in the audience. We're so glad you came out today. ConocoPhillips will be supporting and sponsoring all of our students for the next year. We're thrilled. Thank you so much, ConocoPhillips. Thank you. I'd also like to recognize two people in the audience. We have Consul General Dirk Jansen. If you could raise your hand, there he is. He is the Dutch Consul General in San Francisco, responsible for the entire West Coast, including his new favorite state, the state of Alaska. And we are so thrilled to have him. And right behind him is the glorious Irene Green, our Dutch honorary consul here in Alaska, powerhouse force of nature. Irene, thank you so much for making this possible today. If you're currently not a member of the Alaska World Affairs Council, please do join. Your memberships matter. It allows us to do things like this throughout the year and sponsor our student programs. So do please become a member. And thank you, Rocky Runyon. Is he here? He renewed his membership this morning. Oh, Rocky, I don't see you. There you are. Well, hi, Rocky. Thank you for renewing your membership this morning and for coming and seeing and having your glorious smiling face. Thanks, Rocky. Next month, we're going to be back here in September. And September 16th, we will be partnering with the Wilson Center from Washington, D.C. Dr. Mike Sprager will be sitting in that chair, where we'll have both the Norwegian and the Finnish ambassador. And a similar type of format. So with that, we'll go ahead and start. This format, Ambassador Unplugged, is a format which our young professionals came together and said, hey, we would really love it if you could do a program and talk about some of the things that are really important and interesting to us. And they gave us a whole list. And we want to talk about all of that. And we know that there's not a lot of time, but we also want to hear from all of you. So this is an interactive opportunity for you to talk directly to the ambassador and ask him his perspective on whatever topic you'd like from the Dutch perspective. So my friend Greg Wolf and I, we're going to start off the conversation on some of these topics and then just open it up to the floor. So think about your question and we'll get right to that. So we'll just start right away here. And first of all, welcome very much to Alaska. It's so great to see you here in our glorious state. What brings you to Alaska? Why is Alaska interesting to the Netherlands?
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you very much for hosting me and to the Alaska World Affairs Council. And I'm also very happy that I'm hopefully the number one in a long row of visitors that will come over after the,
Yeah, better. Okay. So I repeat also for the audience at home. Thank you very much for inviting me. Great to be here at the Alaska World Affairs Council meeting. As you mentioned, it's an honor for me to be, after a long time, a first guest here as well. And I hope many more will follow. I became ambassador to the United States in 2019. And I started with visiting our consul generals. And we have five CGs, as we call them. You mentioned one of them already, Dirk, in San Francisco. But we also have them in Chicago, in New York, in Atlanta, and in Florida, in Miami. And though they have the responsibility for trade issues, the broader issues, but mainly focusing on trade. And I wanted to visit them first. And secondly, I said I'm going to do states that are of interest, and Alaska was obviously one of them, is one of them, and I'll explain in a minute why. But then the pandemic started and traveling became very, very difficult or impossible. So now the restrictions are gradually being reduced. We're able to travel more easily now. So I thought this is the time to come to Alaska. I think in terms of weather and all that, this is also the best period to come. As you just mentioned, my Norwegian and Finnish colleagues will come in a month time. So going to Alaska mainly with the idea of looking for economic possibilities for cooperation, so for trade opportunities, for doing business together. There are two main areas, I would say. I mean, the relationship with Alaska is of course a part of the relationship with the United States, and I can say something about that as well. But all the areas where we work together with the United States, with, I would say, mainly on defense and on trade and investment, we are looking for opportunities in Alaska as well. So that is what took me to Alaska. And of course, I mean, going to Alaska also, as a child, you read about Alaska, you learn about Alaska, you know it's far away, and I can tell you it's really far away. We live in DC, and it's easier for me to travel back to my home country in terms of time than to come from DC to Anchorage. But still, it's great to be here.
Greg, on to you.
Okay, first of all, I want to welcome you, Mr. Ambassador, to Alaska and to Anchorage. As Lisa introduced, I'm the Executive Director of the World Trade Center. We're part of the global network of World Trade Centers headquartered in New York. There are approximately 300 World Trade Centers in 90 countries, and we've been here for 34 years. So we're not quite as old as the World Affairs Council, but we're very happy to welcome you. The Netherlands is one of Alaska's top trading partners among European countries and has been for a number of years. But today I wanted to ask a question, not about trade, but about investment. And this is one area where the Netherlands, when I think about the Netherlands, sometimes it seems to me to use a sort of saying, like a boxing above your weight. In other words, your weight class. Netherlands is a small country, not a huge population, and yet when it comes to global investment, the Netherlands leads the world in foreign direct investment. And it's also a large investor in the United States, and vice versa, the United States is a large investor in the Netherlands. How did the Netherlands become such a big global player in investment?
Yeah, well, first of all, indeed, we are the fifth biggest investor in the United States. If you look at Dutch companies, and many of them you will know, the Heineken, the Philips, Shell, the big companies that are all there, but also the smaller companies, they create for about, or they support for about 850,000 jobs in the United States, which is a lot. The other way around, the United States is the biggest investor in the Netherlands, creating for about 200,000 jobs. All the major companies are present there as well. I think for the Netherlands, we are an attractive, for foreign companies, we are an attractive destination because of our location. First of all, the port of Rotterdam is well known. The airport of Schiphol is well known. We are very, let's say, centrally located in Europe. That's important. I think our expertise. Most people speak Dutch, and I realize often people who want to come to the Netherlands and want to learn speaking Dutch, they find it very frustrating because immediately Dutch people start talking in English instead of continue to speak in Dutch. So that's, I think, important, but also skilled labor, highly qualified persons that are available. So in that respect, I think the Netherlands is an interesting country for investing. The other way around, we are, as you mentioned already, a relatively small country, 17 million inhabitants. In terms of size, you can drive from the northern border to the southern border in 2.5 hours. I went to Seward on Sunday, it was. It also took me for about 2.5 hours, just to give you an idea. So it's relatively small, and that means that we are depending on the outside world as well. So traditionally, we've always been a great exporting nation, looking further than Europe, to other countries as well, with a past, of course, that has given us a lot of wealth, but that we are also now to come to realize more that it has its negative aspects as well, if you talk about slavery and all those kind of things. But, I mean, the focus on doing international business is in our genes. It's always there. And so you're looking for business and investment opportunities around the world in many sectors. Agriculture is a clear one. Water is a clear one, also related to the climate challenges, which we can talk about a bit later, I hope. Energy is obviously one, life science and health. But also, I mean, Dirk's office is focusing very much on scale-ups and startups in the in Silicon Valley and broader as well, because it's not only the West Coast, but we look at Boston, for instance, for innovation and for life science and health. So there we see many Dutch companies and public investors looking for investment possibilities. So that's why the United States is an important country for us, and it's also for us important that America remains open. So, I mean, Buy American is important, and I understand the advantages of that, but we believe in a model where countries work together, where we have open borders and as much as free trade as possible.
Okay, so let's talk a little bit about climate. And it's interesting, you just went down to Seward. So I bicycled from here to Seward. Not a very safe road to do that. Netherlands has one of the safest roads for bicycling. I would much rather be bicycling in the Netherlands. Sounds like a good idea. But when I think about the Netherlands, I think about windmills and flowers. And what is the Netherlands' view on climate and alternative energy?
Yeah, but just on the biking, it's important that you have an infrastructure as well. And I think for the Netherlands, and I just spoke to some people who biked in the Netherlands, we have an infrastructure. So, I mean, of course, it's relatively flat. That helps. Although with the electric bikes, you can cover a larger distance and you have to bike less. But you have to have your path, you have to have your traffic lights, the whole flow, et cetera, which is very important. So if you want, you know, to make it a sustainable road from Anchorage to Seward, you have to invest in your bike lanes as well and all that. By the way, I would like to congratulate people from Seward. I was there and I saw many signs for Lydia Jacobi, your Olympic medal winner in swimming. Congratulations. Well done. So, I mean, you have to invest in that, I would say, for your bike. Then on your question on climate change, I think yesterday it was the report of the IPCC that came out on climate change. For me personally, two things stood out there. The first one is that it clearly shows that the change in climate is caused by human behavior. If there are any doubts about that, it is us that causes the changes in temperature through a number of activities that we do. The other thing is that actually the results show in the report that it's worse than we thought, so that we have to do more in terms of climate change and both adaptation and mitigation than we thought we would do. I think we have a European policy when it comes to climate change, and the individual 27 member states have to translate that policy into national plans and national objectives. When it comes to CO2 reduction, when it comes to making your households more sustainable, when it comes to your energy objectives, you have to work on that. We've done so. We have quite a number of ambitious targets for 2030, for 2035. For instance, when it comes to heating houses, we want to move away from the traditional fossil fuels and see for other possibilities. We invest a lot in energy, solar energy, in wind energy. Obviously, wind is something that we have a lot in the Netherlands. But that's not enough, I would say. We have to invest more. Also in storage, we are strong in carbon capture storage, but you have to develop more when it comes to storage of energy. The energy that you raise during summer, you should be able to store somewhere and use it in your winter time. So we have companies that are specialized in that. And when it comes to the link of, you know, climate change and doing business again, you know, we have companies that are strong in risk assessment, in recommending measures that you can take for your climate adaptation. And also, again, on the border of water, what does the rising sea level mean for countries like the Netherlands? 2/3 of our country is below sea level. That requires more investments, probably, but it also requires investment in knowledge. How can we deal with it? We have companies that are very active. Fugro is present here. They help to develop, if I'm well informed, nautical charge and update them. We have Arcadis as a company that is very active here as well. So, I mean, I think it is important to combine the measures that we have to take with business opportunities and creating jobs. And I think that's possible to combine, let's say, a new green economy. And it doesn't mean that we have to get rid of everything from one day to another. I think we will still be dependent on fossil fuels for some time, but we gradually have to make a change towards, I would say, a greener kind of energy.
Oh my gosh, there's so many questions I have within that. I'm going to try to be, okay, I'll hold back, but all of you ask about flooding and erosion and all the preparedness that's going on in the Netherlands. Greg,
yeah.
Over to you.
Okay. Mr. Ambassador, we started talking about the role and the prominent role that that your country plays in global investment. I want to talk about another area which will probably surprise people, and that is the prominent role you play in the export of food around the world. As I understand it, you're probably the second largest food exporter in the world, only behind the United States. Now, I think people can understand someone being a food exporter if they have a large land mass like the United States or Canada or Australia, someplace like that. But you mentioned you can drive from one end of your country to the other in a couple hours. How do you do it? I understand some of it is produced locally, some of it is re-exported. I imagine it's coming from other parts of Europe, maybe. But can you shed some light on how your country is the second largest exporter of food in the world?
Yeah. Well, I mentioned already that exporting is in our genes, looking outward. We've been traditionally a country of agriculture, but we have changed over the centuries, actually. And our agricultural sector has become very knowledge intensive. So that means that with a relatively small surface, we can create a very high production. We were this morning at Bell's Nursery to look at greenhouses. Greenhouses, obviously, you have in many different ways, but you can, I would almost say, update the greenhouse in such a way that it has a very smart water technology, that it has a very smart energy technology, that you use light which you create yourself, even in different colors, because different colors of light have different influence on either your tomatoes, your cucumbers, the flowers that you want to grow. So you can, I mean, you can invest in that and use it in a smart way. We are helped with that by the University of Wageningen, which is, I would say, being modest, but it's a world-renowned agricultural university. And there, I would say, the combination of the public sector investing, the private sector giving enough business opportunities, and the knowledge sector, especially Wageningen, working together in what we call the Golden Triangle, is key for, you know, us to be the biggest exporter of agricultural products. But I have to say, I mean, the COVID pandemic learned us many things. And one of the things it learned was, it taught us was that your supply chains are very vulnerable. Supply chains when it comes to medicine and medical machines, but also when it comes to food. And we have to look, that's I think the challenge for us now as well, to look at even more sustainable ways, not only of growing your products and exporting them. We do a lot of agricultural cooperation with the United States as well. I mean, I mentioned Belt Nursery with the greenhouses, but if you look at another state, the state of Kentucky, we have a big greenhouse project there with a combination of the private sector and the knowledge institutes working together on increasing your productivity on a relatively small surface and then developing the business chain. So here the products that are grown are mainly for the local market. And I think one of the things that, you know, bringing your food closer to the local market is very important. So that means that you again have to invest more and that you have to be smarter when growing your products. And there the Netherlands can help with knowledge, but also, for instance, that's the last example that I will give, growing seeds is very important. Your varieties that you have, you can further develop the variety of your seeds for all kinds of products. That is done in the Netherlands as well, and that's an export product for us as well. So I think that's why we are being a relatively small country when it comes to service, because we are so knowledge intensive in our agricultural sector, we punch above our weight.
Once again, okay, and you have one more question, is that right?
Yes.
Okay, so before that, and then we'll take questions from the audience, I want to talk about gender equality. So Iceland ranks number one in gender equality, Netherlands is 38, US is 51. How is gender equality viewed in the Netherlands? What's the atmosphere there?
Yeah. Well, 38, there's definitely room for improvement. I think I look at gender equality in a broader sense. I bring it into the perspective of everything that has to do with diversity and being inclusive. Because it's shown that, for instance, more inclusive societies and more diverse organizations just do a better job. So that means that you have to look at possibilities or create possibilities for support organizations, society becoming more diverse and more inclusive. We do a lot in the Netherlands, but still not enough, I would say. Part of the explanation is that traditionally the role of the woman has been very much focused on, specifically after the woman got married and children, that she would start working from home, that she would stop working and that the men would continue to work. We realize that we have to invest in that in order to give more possibilities for the young mother or the little bit older mother to work as well. So we are investing in childcare. We are encouraging with special subsidies women to work and go back to the labor market. Many of our men and women work part-time. So that means that if you look at the total figures, and that's not an excuse, but there are no excuses, but it puts it a little bit in perspective. It shows why the number of women of the total population working is relatively low, but many women work part-time as well. Having said that, I think it's important to have role models. We see them a lot in sports. We see them gradually becoming more in politics, but not enough, but it's coming. We should see them more in other areas like art, and of course in the private sector. And it takes time. If I look at my own job, being a diplomat, when I joined the foreign ministry in 87, I would say still 80% of the young diplomats were male. If you look at it now, it's more or less 50-50 at the start of recruiting young diplomats. But if you go to the higher echelons, you see that during the course of their, in this case, diplomatic career, women stop to pursue their diplomatic career, sometimes because of children, sometimes because they have a partner that wants to go abroad maybe for one time, but then he has his own, he or she, they have their own jobs as well, and it's not always easy to find a job abroad for the partner. So that's why you have to look specifically, in this case I mentioned the example of diplomats, you have to look specifically what kind of measures you can take. And when I talk about the Foreign Service, we now are working on the target of having more female ambassadors. Well, Norway is doing a better job in that respect, but it's coming, it's coming. Yeah.
Okay, on to Greg. If anyone has a question, Jen Motika, who's a new board member of the Alaska World Affairs Council, will be standing here with the microphone, so you don't have to touch it. You can just come on up and line up here, and we can take questions from the audience after Greg. Go ahead.
Okay, while you're doing that, I'll ask a question about the Arctic. You know, the United States is a member of the Arctic Council, along with other northern Arctic countries. America is part of the Arctic Council, really, because of Alaska. We make the United States an Arctic nation. It wouldn't be because of Iowa or Mississippi or some state like that. So, I noticed over the years that the Netherlands joined the Arctic Council as an observer, a permanent observer, one of the observer nations. And I'm just wondering if you could just sort of broadly tell us what is the Netherlands' interest in the Arctic, sort of what are your goals or priorities in pursuing those things in the Arctic?
Yeah. Well, as you mentioned, I mean, in Europe we have three countries being Arctic countries. Eh? You have Finland, you have Denmark, and you have Sweden, obviously.
Russia.
Yeah, but I said in the European Union. not on the short term, I expect Russia to join the European Union. So they are, let's say, directly involved, but we are indirectly involved. First of all, as we discussed already, through climate change, everything that happens affects the Arctic Circle as well and has its consequences when it comes to, you know, the defrost of the Arctic Circle, more water going down as well. What does it mean? A gradually defrosting of the Arctic Circle might also have consequences for security policy. Look at the freedom of navigation, and will it be possible to create new navigation ways for the Netherlands? As I mentioned earlier, freedom of navigation is very important. So there we have an indirect interest. So climate change I mentioned already, but also in terms of security, I mean, we are training a lot of our military staff here as well. By the way, we are, I mean, I mentioned defense in the beginning. F-35 is a fighter plane that we are buying, that we are working on together with the United States, not only buying, but also the training, the maintenance, et cetera, et cetera. And I know that 2 weeks ago in Fairbanks, there was a great F-35 show. So we are involved there as well. And there's a lot of training also in the Arctic. And if the environment changes, it has consequences for us as well, also in the field of defense. So that's why we are looking at it. We find it important. We also believe in the concept of multilateral cooperation. That means countries sitting together and working on common solutions for the problems that we have. A special Arctic ambassador who goes to meetings, who meets with people. So that's the different angles that we are looking at when it comes to our Arctic policy, but we realize that for you, because of your location, you know, it's very much different, much more important. But still, we have an interest as well.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's an opportunity to ask the ambassador anything you'd like.
So, thank you very much, Ambassador, for coming. Very much appreciate having the opportunity to see you and all of you in person. Following up a bit on your comments just now, in terms of among the effects of climate change, we have the possibility of Arctic transportation, Arctic sea routes and various there's also, of course, air routes as well. What are the possibilities in terms of Alaska and the Netherlands becoming part of transportation connections using the Arctic?
Yeah, thank you very much. Well, I think we are going to visit the airport, I think, tomorrow or day after tomorrow. And I know that Anchorage is a major hub when it comes to freight transport, so that is very important. I also know that that our national carrier KLM used to fly on Alaska, but that was a time that the stop was needed to fuel, and planes have become more efficient. So that means that from that perspective, you don't have to stop for, let's say, in Alaska for an extra fuel. So you'll see that we mainly, our tourists, if they want to go to Alaska, and again, for a Dutch tourist, it's a long way, they either use a German carrier or Iceland. I'm expecting that that will not change in the short term. Having said that, we can work together in other areas when it comes to aviation. There is a Dutch company working with Boeing and also Alaska Air on making fuel aviation more sustainable. Again, there you have an interest as well, I think. So I look more at those possibilities than think that we can strengthen the flights between Amsterdam and Alaska. But again, it's up to the private sector. I mean, if KLM sees possibilities, I would very much support them to do so.
Okay. We're going to go biking in the Netherlands, right, Dr. Danska?
Good afternoon, Ambassador. My first question is kind of touching on two points you've already made with the IPCC and with the agriculture. My question is, do you think there is a future in the type of farming that is mainly conducted in the U.S. with a lot of methane-based outcomes? And do you believe there is a different future in terms of mass agriculture, vertical farming? Where do you think we need to go as human society in terms of that farming to reduce our impact on climate change and CO2 emissions? And then, I don't know if this is allowed for a personal question, are you a Verstappen fan?
Am I?
Are you a Verstappen fan?
Verstappen. Oh yeah, okay. Sorry, I didn't get that. Verstappen, yeah, well, I didn't expect that question, so I didn't have that in the frame. Well, to start with the second question, Verstappen, for those of you who don't know, is a Formula One driver who does very well. I mean, I can't say I'm not a fan, you know, he's Dutch and we're very proud of him. But currently, you know, Mercedes and Honda are really in a row. To see which at the end of the season will be, but yeah, of course we hope he will be a world champion. Hopefully this season again. Your question on the future of agriculture, I would say that if you look at the agriculture in the United States, you mainly see that it's agriculture on a very large scale. I mean, I traveled through Nebraska not so long ago, and you see miles and miles and miles of corn fields, and in those corn, and then you have the railway along those corn fields, and you have in the small cities the huge silos, and that's the infrastructure, and that's the way how you produce your goods, and it gives you a clear advantage, a benefit of scale, obviously, but I don't know if it will remain a competitive model on the long term, because as I mentioned earlier, agriculture will also become more knowledge intensive. So there are other ways to bring your products closer to the market with using less territory, with using smarter solutions. So I think, and again, who am I to say that, but I think the challenge for agriculture in the United States will be to gradually move away from this large-scale production and to invest more in a modern kind of agriculture, closer to your markets, with less harm for the environment as well. And I think that's clearly possible. I mean, it requires an investment in infrastructure. I hope that the infrastructure bill will be passed, It will mean a huge investment in the broader infrastructure, so in your roads, in your railroads, in your airports. I think that is required, and then of course you have to invest in your whole supply chain as well, and making it more modern. I mean, for the Netherlands, if we import flowers from, for instance, Kenya on Sunday evening, they are brought with a plane, cooled and all that, of course, to the Netherlands at Schiphol Airport. They are distributed to the big flower auction in Aalsmeer. On Monday morning at 6 o'clock, they are in front of the flower auction and they're being sold. They're being transported again to any location in the Netherlands or in Europe. But in the Netherlands, you will be able to find your coronation or your rose that you want to buy on Monday afternoon can easily come from Kenya, where it was cut and packed on one day before. So investing, you know, in a very smart way of transport and in your supply chain is very important as well. So I think, again, we are ready to work, and we do a lot of things already with the United States, but we are ready to continue that cooperation.
Just following up on that, so your conversation about exports and the Netherlands punching above your weight, that you are the second largest exporter. So if we then start investing in infrastructure to have hydroponics and that sort of thing closer to our markets, it's kind of putting you out of a job. So do you have technology that is also very interesting from the Netherlands that places like Alaska could use for their own hydroponics to grow food and flowers closer to market?
Well, yes, I think I mentioned the greenhouse technology already. I think that's the main one and that we are looking at. But there are, other solutions, for instance, to monitor the growing of your products as well, which can be one. But the broader comment I would make, I mean, we are not afraid of other countries becoming more competitive. That's the way I think that requires us to continue with our innovation as well. I believe in a model where you have an open market where you can compete with each other, and the challenge there is that if you're outrun by another country, you have to be smarter and think of other ways, you know, to become more competitive again. And that's exactly, and then I make a small political remark, that's exactly the challenge that we have, we, the United States and Europe, the United States and the Netherlands, with a country like China. Because China is not an open market. It's very difficult for American or European countries to enter the Chinese market. The Chinese market is supported by local subsidies, so it's not a level playing field. Many Dutch companies who go to China have problems with, and not only in China, but also in the Netherlands, with protecting their intellectual property rights for their products. So in that case, there is not a fair level playing field, and it's very difficult to outsmart your opponent because you're not working on this at the same level. And that's why we are also with the United States critical on China when it comes to the trade practices that they exercise, and why we are, let's say, in a coalition to ensure that we have a stronger global level playing field in that respect.
Fascinating.
Thank you. Welcome to the Alaska, the last frontier. I have several questions, so you pick the one you like, or let's say ignore the one you don't like. You mentioned you are developing seeds. Are these genetically modified seeds? That's one question. You talk about your leadership in agricultural export. I'm aware of cheese and chocolate. The cheese is dairy, dairy is cows, cows is methane. Are you doing something about all that methane? Next question, you mentioned the flower market. And we have something here in Alaska that is new. We have peonies that come to market at a time that nobody else in the world does. Are you making an effort to connect with our peony growers?
Okay, let's start there. That's a lot to remember. Get my head around.
One more. The easiest one. Our big export is oil. Is Royal Dutch Shell coming back?
Okay, more questions.
Even my pen stopped, so I didn't write all your four questions down. Well, on Royal Shell, I think it's their responsibility to decide whether they want to come back or not. As far as I'm informed, they don't have plans currently, but they have still, I think, an investment somewhere, but I don't think they are looking back currently. They're looking at coming back because, as we discussed earlier, also a company like Shell, and in our country, Shell has been summoned by a court to ensure that their company will achieve certain sustainable results when it comes to their energy policy. That they, you know, they should commit themselves to bringing the fossil fuels in their portfolio down and investing more in alternative energy resources. So Shell is in this case forced by our courts to change their policy.
So they're
going to
go after the cow's methane, hey?
Yeah, that's, I don't know. But that is something I would say. When it comes to the cows and all that, I mean, well, the products that you mentioned, chocolate, I could highly recommend from the Netherlands. Dairy, I could highly recommend, but it's broader. It's vegetables. It's potatoes, by the way. You grow them here as well. I mean, Van Welen, whom we will visit in Palmer, I think, on day after tomorrow, is the biggest potato grower in Alaska, but we export them as well. Vegetables, fruit, and all that. But again, you need your supply chain with all the cool storage and all that. It needs to be up and running, and it needs to be efficient if you want to, you know, have your products arrive at the destination, at your destination, fresh and ready to be sold. What you mentioned about the cows, you're 100% correct. I think that's one of our challenges that we are facing currently. The methane level through the cows, the fertilizer that we use, I don't think that is a sustainable model that we can continue to do so. And it's a real challenge because we have European targets. Our government will translate these targets into national targets, and that means actually that in the end we will have to reduce the number of cows probably, and in the end that will also mean that we have to reduce the number of farmers being active in livestock, in this specific term, in cows. That's not easy, also because of our tradition, as we mentioned earlier, but I think it's going to happen. Again, we've made progress there when it comes to being more efficient, and there are also very strict lines, guidelines when it comes to having your livestock, how you treat your animals, not only on the farm, but also with transport and all that. But it's a very good question. For the Dutch, it requires a different approach in our livestock investment and in for our farmers, we have to change as well.
And the peonies, have a peonies farm, but it seems like the growing season in Alaska is so short that there's still a market for a hydroponic type of growth.
Yeah, that's true. And I must compliment you because I've seen the peonies, and I got a few on our hotel room when we arrived. I mean, they're beautiful. I mean, you can be proud of that product. They smell nice, they look great. So clearly you have an advantage there. I don't think we can add much to that anymore. But you know, the broader, I mean, the flower area is something for cooperation. But again, you need to look at the supply lines. You also mentioned the seeds. I think it was your first question. The seed, the variety of seeds and growing seeds is very broad. It's high tech. In 2019, Simon Groot, a Dutchman, he received the World Agricultural, the World Food Prize, which is every year awarded in Iowa, in Des Moines. It's a kind of Nobel Prize for agriculture and food. And he is one of our experts on seed and seed growing and making new varieties of seed. Again, that's very high tech. How can you make your seed more sustainable? How can you make your seed in such a way that it requires less water? How can you make your seed in such a way that it gets, it's less vulnerable for diseases? So that's something that we are working on as well. But the idea is, yeah, again, if you export your seeds, other countries can use that knowledge as well. And it happens. And that means that we have to continue investing in that sector as well in order to remain ahead of the curve. I don't know if I answered all your questions, but I hope at least the majority.
Well, I can make up more.
I think we have more people who are interested in asking questions. As you're coming up, I want to pose one that our younger group came with when it comes to mental illness. So Simone Biles, our gymnast for the Olympics, stepped back for a while for mental health. And we're used to seeing that when it comes to physical injuries, but we're not used to seeing that for mental histories. You and I had this conversation about Naomi Osaka, the number one ranked tennis player, doing the same. How is that viewed in the Netherlands? How is mental illness viewed? And with athletes, how is she viewed, Simone Biles, when this happened?
Yeah. Well, it's a very good question, and I'm also interested in in that. I've seen the Netflix documentary on Naomi Osaka. If you haven't seen it, it's worthwhile, because it actually shows how much pressure from a very young age we all of us, the sponsors, the media, sometimes also the parents and, you know, the family around it, puts, how much pressure we put on our athletes. And especially in some sports where they have to start already at a young age, and let's be honest, almost every sport you have to start at a young age, the expectations are so high. I think for the Netherlands, we've done quite well at the Olympics, by the way. We're very proud to be the highest ranking European country, and number 7 on the total ranking. That's also because the United Kingdom is not part of EU anymore, otherwise we would have been the 2nd. But ahead of Germany and France and Italy, so we're very proud of that. But I think one of the things we do is that we combine at a relatively early stage, we encourage top athletes to not only invest in their sport, but also invest in something else, in a career. Use that knowledge during your active period as an athlete, you will at least hopefully be able to use that as for the period after you stopped being a sportsman or a sportswoman. So that means that mentally, you know that if you don't succeed in your sport, there is an alternative as well. And I think it's good for us to support that idea. Sports is important, and we all would like to win the gold medals and have our athletes being the best, but we should be able to look at it from a different perspective as well and encourage the youngsters to do something else. Of course, they have to have help as well, which is very important. And to be honest, I mean, Simone Biles has been very brave by taking a step back, you know, at the highlight of where everybody is watching to the Olympic Games in Japan, and say at that moment, I cannot do it. I think what I noticed in the United States, but also in Europe, is that we should appreciate if athletes are so honest and brave to step forward and say it's too much. For Naomi Osaka, I think, she canceled participation to a few tennis tournaments. She didn't show up at press conference. I think we should also be, and that's for the press, be aware that, you know, sometimes the questions that are being asked to these athletes are very personal. And you sit there in front of a whole audience, the whole world is watching, and then you're being asked very personal questions to athletes at a very young age, 19, 20 years. I mean, come on, let's give them a break. So we have to find a kind of balance act where we do not only focus on where we respect the athlete and look at other possibilities for them as well, also after their sports career.
More kindness. I love it.
Thank you for coming to Alaska, Ambassador, and thank you, Greg and Lisa, for putting this all on. I have a comment, a couple questions and an invitation. First of all, I wanted to congratulate the Dutch for having the best Summer Olympics ever and for the outstanding performances. That was really, really fun to
watch.
Thank you. And thank you for speaking to the courage of Simone Biles. And the, you know, the Western civilization is founded on the Greek ideal of healthy minds and healthy bodies. So having something else besides athletics is very important. So the questions I have are, have your climate scientists come up with a probability of being able to host an Elfstedentag in any year, given year?
Sorry,
the 11 cities tour.
Sorry, can you,
what do your climate scientists say are the probability of being able to host that in any given year? And will you ever be able to host another one?
Okay, well, I should give a little bit explanation because I don't know if everybody knows the 11 cities tour in the Netherlands. First of all, let me also compliment you with the color of your tie, which is a very good color for the Dutch. the 11 cities tour is a skating tour on natural ice in the northern province of Friesland for about 200 kilometers. That would be about 120 miles, more or less, on natural ice. The last one that was held was in 97. I'm looking at my wife, at the 4th of January, wasn't it?
No.
97, yes, that's what I say, 97, on the 4th of January. And I know because we were married at the 3rd of January, and we stayed in a hotel, and we woke up very early at 3 o'clock to watch the start of that tour. So that's indeed 97, that's almost 25 years ago. The predictions are that with the current trend, it's going to be highly unlikely that that traditional skating tour will ever be held. Because you need at least, I would say, depending of course on the temperatures, but you need at least, I would say, a week of strong freezing, not only during the night, but also during the day. So minus zero, and if that doesn't happen, which it hasn't done for at least 25 years, it's not going to take place. Combined with the fact that I think these kind of sports events have become so popular that you do not only attract the skaters that come to do the tour, but you have so many supporters who want to watch along the road, maybe even on the ice, that it requires a huge organization. You see it sometimes at another popular sport, the Tour de France and biking, cycling. The supporters who come so close to the cyclists that it becomes very difficult to keep them at a distance. So I think the combination of the climate change and the fact that it has become a huge event makes it, in my view, unlikely, unfortunately, that it will ever be held again in the Netherlands. We have a big tour every year in Austria on the Weissensee, 200 kilometers. And of course indoor, because indoor we have a lot of good skating facilities and the Dutch skaters do quite well on Olympic winter games and on win, but that's all indoor. So unfortunately, I'm afraid that is not going to happen anymore.
So I had the good fortune to sneak into the 1997 event at Dimshit.
Okay, congrats.
Here's my invitation. I'd like to invite Nederlanders to come on an Alaska winter adventure vacation, come ski at Alyeska, and we have an outdoor roll in Midtown you can skate on.
All right.
Come around the Iditarod time.
Okay, good. I will communicate that to the Dutch skating board, but thank you very much for the invitation.
Yes, so all that are streaming in on the live stream, come to Alaska. We skate and we ski, and we'd love to have you.
Again, I'd like to thank you so much for taking the time today to meet with all of us here in Anchorage and just teaching us a little bit more about Dutch policies and just what you stand for and giving us that educational perspective. So I do work for Alaska Seeds of Change as one of our lead greenhouse growers. I used to supervise a group of youth under our WIOA program, which stands for the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act. And that was allowing youth in our community to gain the skills that they need to empower themselves and move on into the community when they have often experienced mental health, criminal history, and other barriers to employment that might advance those job opportunities for them. And so we have used hydroponics at our Midtown hydroponics farm to teach those job skills that are very important to youth just curious, because the Netherlands has used hydroponics for decades, and we have certainly based our model partially on the Dutch and just like inspiration and that aspect. So how do you all empower youth in the Netherlands with sustainable agriculture, whether it's hydroponics or just traditional farming?
So the question is, how do we empower youth when it comes to agriculture specifically? Well, if you look at the agricultural sector, it's still very much a family business. So the sons and the daughters, the sons and the daughters of the farmers decide whether they want to take over the farm of their parents. If not, the Dutch government does not encourage a takeover of the farm, but wants to buy the farm themselves in order to give it a different destination. As I mentioned earlier, the challenges when it comes to our farms, that in fact we need, in the end, I would say less farmers than more, and a different kind of agriculture. So those farms who will not be taken over by the family members are often sold either to the government or to organizations that look after nature development. And the farms become more a part of the broader nature conservation processes that we have in our country. Having said that, I mean, of course, if you want to be a farmer, it is a possibility, but it's much more than the traditional image that you might have of the wooden shoes and the windmills. It has become a kind of high-tech business model as well. And then I think the combination of not being in the farming community and from outside, I think it doesn't happen that much anymore. On the culture here and the cooperation when it comes to flowers and all that, I mean, one of the objectives that we are here for is also to look into the possibility in the next 2-3 days for closer cooperation in this agricultural sector. And if we would come over with a mission, we would certainly have youngsters part of that mission as well, and I hope they will be received by young people here as well with ambitions in the agricultural sector.
Well, that'd be great. We are running out of time. Laura, if you have a quick question, we'd love to have that as our last question for the hour.
Thank you. This is actually a phone-in question from one of our young professionals, and it actually ties very closely to her question. With the future of hydroponics and how the Netherlands is leading the change, what some of our young professionals are curious about is the future of marijuana growing. Because we, yes, right? It's become a thing here in Alaska in the last, you know, 5-6 years. But also, I know it's illegal on the Netherlands on the national level, but not in Amsterdam, which is kind of known for its cafes, or its coffee shops, excuse me. So what kind of future do you see there as a lot of millennials and Gen Zers see that as a burgeoning industry for Alaska and the world to invest in?
Yeah, it's a good question. You described, I think, our policy very well, and it's very complicated as well, because although it's forbidden on the national level, there are still possibilities on the local level to sell marijuana and soft drugs in coffee shops and all that, but there are strict rules combined with it, a limited amount that's being able to sell. You have to show where you buy your product from. Often there is a link with organized crime as well, and it's something clearly that we want to combat. So you want to legalize it in some way, for medical use as well and all that, but at the same time control all the negative through the years. We've become more aware of the fact that there are negative aspects connected to it as well. So we are now, I would say, at a level where we look more into the best possibilities of legalizing it for medical use and also for a very limited number for leisure, if you can call it like that. But for the rest, we're also looking very strict at the negative aspects of it. that often come along with it. And there I don't see, also because, you know, you have to look at that at the European perspective as well. If the Netherlands would completely legalize it, we would have a lot of people from neighboring countries coming to the Netherlands with possible negative consequences as well. So we are also investing in a kind of European approach to have one common policy in that respect. But that's difficult.
Well, big round of applause for our speaker today. I want to thank everyone on behalf of the Alaska World Affairs Council and the World Trade Center of Alaska for this program today. Thank you so much for joining us and our commitment to global competency and increasing awareness of what is going around in the world. A warm thank you to our feature speaker, His Excellency Ambassador Andre Hospels, and of course, Dirk Johnson, thank you for coming. And do we have a social media guru winner? Oh, we do. You've been watching, huh?
Lillian Swan,
come on up. Coming, and as a student, ConocoPhillips says you can come anytime for free, and when we have lunches, free lunch for you. If you didn't see everything on your trip to Seward, we have a book of Alaska, a National Geographic book, that has some pictures that will hopefully entice you to come to our great state again. On behalf of the World Affairs Council, here's a book for you.
Thank you very much.
And Greg, we know you love your coffee, and we love you, so here is a mug from the Alaska World Affairs Council for your coffee. Thank you so much for partnering with us again. And thank you. I hope to see everyone when we're back here on the 16th of September for another Ambassador's Unplugged program. Have a great rest of your day.
Thank you.